live stream. We are setting up for a return flight to Toronto from Memphis. Did a Canadian Express fly-in last night, October 20th, from Toronto to here in Memphis, Tennessee, and now we are heading back. We are now flying the 748 cargo variant, and from PMDG, we are using FS Dream Team's Memphis and Flight Tampa's Toronto. Sit back, enjoy the flight, and I'm going to start, we are at cold and dark, so I'm going to start things up and get things loaded, and we'll be off in probably about 10 minutes. Sit back and enjoy.
Uh-huh. Hello, Captain. We are ready for pushback. Locking gear. Departure check completed. Bypass bin inserted. Release parking brakes. Commencing push. All engines clear. Starboard wheel.
that's going to be 7 for anybody who's using it off. Test, test, 1, 2, 3, the mic. Test, test.
retract the whole assembly into the F-ring. Because otherwise you have that rumbling noise all the time. Why do these aircraft makers work with retractable lights? I don't know. I mean, the easiest thing really, I think, would have been to put that somewhere into the wing route. Like, you know, in a 747, I think they have that. But yeah, Airbus here, 320, they don't have that.
So basically, if I understand it correctly, then you leave them on until you're at 10,000 feet, and same for descending below 10,000.
Exactly, because then you want to, you know, signal other people, hey, I'm here, right? Very bright lights, easy to see, even during daytime. So that's why you have them on all the time, below 10,000 feet. But you usually do not have them in the off position. It's either retract or on. The only exception is for some SOPs to put them into the off position when lining up onto the runway.
Right, that makes sense. Would you also have the turn-off light on, or would you keep that off after takeoff?
Well, there's the procedure that because these landing lights, so the turn-off lights, so the left switch, runway turn-off, and the right one, the nose lights, taxi takeoff position, they are all situated on the nose gear simply. So when the nose gear is retracted, at that point, those are switched off automatically. So the light doesn't shine anymore when the gear is retracted. And so there's no point in leaving those switches in the on position. And so for some reason, I'm not sure if that came from Airbus at some point, but these procedures have changed. So when you have the flaps retracted, then you switch the turn-off lights and the nose gear lights off, even though they are off anyways because the nose gear has retracted. But that's just procedure in that case. Otherwise, when the landing gear, the nose gear is extended, obviously that helps you on the ground, or when you land with the illumination of the ground. And so yes, you should have them on.
That makes a lot of sense.
Anselmo, welcome. You don't know anything about flying? Don't worry about it. Maybe there are some questions that you have about flying. You've already wondered why is there certain sounds in the aircraft? Or why do pilots do crazy maneuvers sometimes? Feel free to ask.
Yeah, Firefly and me, we take it a bit closer to ACG.
Can A320 NAF display extend runway track to... Yes, it can. You just have to realize that Airbus and Boeing try to be as different as they can. Same goes with the MCDU. However, there is the same kind of trick that can actually paint in an extended center line through the ILS. So when you fly an ILS, for example, let's take this approach here. Even though it doesn't align correctly with the runway, it's an offset approach, but never mind. So 250 inbound track from, let's take inbound. So when you insert insert that approach, let's put the LDA 25 here. And so what you do is put that to... And you put things in and does things. Yes, literally does, but it does it differently. Right, so you find that waypoint, and then you go direct to, so VHAR. When you select that waypoint, just talk about on final, it gives you a radial in option. Right, and the correct inbound course is 250, and that makes the outbound course the opposite course. 070 degrees. So here it's actually correctly programmed. So just select that. So it's highlighted, yellow. Insert. And then it gives you the extended center line. Let's try to pull the... there we go. So that's the e-haul point that we took now on the final. And so now opposite we have this. Yeah, it does work. It has that feature. It's a bit more complicated, that's all. And I should have made a copy of the bike plan before I did that. I know, sometimes, right? So we were on course to X Charlie Hotel. Oh no, we weren't, that's wrong. So good coaching. So what does the radial out, radial in, so the radial in, radial out do? Well, you can draw certain lines into that. Right, so when you select that, you can just use these functions and put in intercept radials or draw in intercept radials. That's all you can do with them.
What does radial out do in that case?
Let's try it out. I never use that in real life because let's go for the final fix again. Alright, so we go again with, let's take this time. So plan. So it has radial in 060. So try radial out 060. Oh no, it's the opposite. It's those radio out 240. Let's see if it draws in the same kind of lining. Alright, so what it does, it draws a radio outbound from that fix. So I've put in like 240. There we are. So from that point that I just used, it draws a radial. However, it deletes that waypoint. That's why we don't use it, because it deletes waypoints. I knew there was some problem with that. Yeah. So the function we only use is the radial with the opposite radial. I've actually forgotten that it does that, because I've never used it. So, we'll try it. So, even I learn something from time to time.
And then I brought it up, then I guess.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Right? Things you don't use here in the plane, for a long time, you tend to forget about them. And that's why I also said that, for me personally, why would, you know, why fly sims? Why do I enjoy doing this? One part is that it helps me actually with my real world job. It gives me the opportunity to look through procedures again, and you know, people ask me questions about things that I don't think about anymore, right? Regarding systems and the MCDU and so on and so on. And so that forces me to look into the books again, you know, think about the systems again. So I do profit from that as well.
Maybe another interesting one. Does the Airbus have tillers on both sides? So, like, do you actually steer the aircraft during taxi with the tiller, or do you still use your rudder pedals for that?
Yeah, the rudder pedals only give you 70-degree deflection of the nose gear, so it's not it's good for when you're taxiing like 20 knots or higher. Then you could you know, use that, just the rudder pedals for nose gear steering as well. But anything slower or you know, kind of steep kind of angles that you need, then you have to tillers. And you have on that note, Airbus, you have to on both sides. So here the co-pilot can actually steer as well. Muscat, you're captain as well. What are you flying, Muscat? So, yeah, minutely, that's a good question, right? Minutely, and that is something that each pilot is always fighting against. And do you remember I talked about the knowledge curve and the experience curve? So let's say you're doing a type rating. Let's say you're doing type rating A320. You get computer-based training programs, you get all the documents needed. You have a very strict syllabus that you go through. You get shown everything, you get told everything, or almost everything. And your knowledge level, when you finish with the type rating, is huge, right? I'm the first one to admit, a fresh co-pilot coming from the type rating course, this knowledge level regarding the Airbus B20 is higher than mine. Simply because after that, you don't fly the Airbus, your experience level goes up, but your knowledge level drops down again. Because humans, with their brains, they have a tendency, they tend to forget things that they don't come in contact with for a while. And hence, there is on every day kind of work, you have things you get in contact with the switches, with the systems, be it hydraulics, be it air conditioning, that sort of stuff. But let's take electric, for example. Right, electric and A320, ooh, that's quite a difficult topic. But it's fully automatic. You don't really touch any of these switches unless you have ground power, right? That's the only switch we need, or the other battery switches. All right, those are the switches you touch once powering the aircraft, but that's it. So the complex system that the electric system actually is in A320, you don't get in contact very often. And so let's say a Czech pilot asks you some questions, says, okay, so let's say the right AC bus 2 fails. So what happens? Time of aircraft.
Test. Just testing the sound system. Test 1, 2, 3. Hey Richard, how's it going? See you're watching. I will be landing soon enough. Layer, I'm assuming you mean overlay. I am using the bean overlay, just the stock setup. There's a video, a YouTube video on how to set it up. It's very simple. Yeah, it's simple. And it doesn't take away too much of your the VC itself, which I don't like. I'm not a big fan of with the Canadian Xpress overlay, but yeah. Yeah, I know. Keep forgetting. I gotta keep my hand on the speed brake lever when I deploy them, so I don't forget to bring them back in. Hey Richard, how's the sound coming out on your end? Is it fairly clear, clean? That's good. Good to know. Tweaking. 6 DME to the ILS, I will deploy the landing gear and flaps 20. Some wind shear going on there, man.
Four thousand.
Well, there seems to be an issue still with the GSX and the 748. So, I guess this flight's done. Enjoyed it, I know. Kind of boring in some sense, but anyways. I will get this Twitch stream going, and I guess it only comes with experience. Have a good one, and safe flight. Take care. Ciao.